This is the Skip Barber spec, which is a little bit lower spec in terms of performance than the Pro Series MX-5 Cup cars. A couple reasons for that. One, we didn't feel like asking Mazda to send us motors that have, you know, had like 20 grand spent on them to blueprint them to make like 5 more horsepower. We figured it was really, really nice that they were giving us stuff, so we just said thank you. That's what you're supposed to do, right?
Absolutely.
So they're a little bit slower. The suspension isn't quite as dialed. It's a pretty basic setup. But lest you think that these cars cannot get the job done, one of our instructors, you guys heard while Mr. Doonan was talking about the motorsports program that Mazda is so wonderfully generous with and supporting racing so well. He told you guys about a guy named Kevin Cook. You guys heard that?
Oh yeah, who hasn't?
Yeah, absolutely. Well, he's an instructor with us, so I claim 100% of the responsibility for his excellent pace and stellar racecraft. That's actually Tyler is responsible for his stellar racecraft. I say just bash your way to the front. Get on TV as fast as possible. Last year at Mid-Ohio, despite the fact that the Skip Barber class is basically a second class in the MX-5 Cup, he put a waxin on the whole field, including all the pro cars, and he won outright. So clearly, the tool is sharp enough for the job.
Perfect.
And what's really, really nice is starting with a very good product to begin with. When we get a Mazda MX-5, it doesn't need a whole lot to become a really good race car. Dave Coleman was talking about how, you know, the MX-5 was made to be very soft. So we need to stiffen it up a little bit. These wouldn't ride that well on the street. So they do have stiffer shocks, stiffer lowering springs, bigger bar. But other than that, the suspension is totally stock. It's all stock components. It's all stock locations. Nothing changed. The motor is completely stock, other than it's got to sound a little racy, right? So we put a race exhaust on it and an intake. So you really get that feel like I am a race car driver. So it makes probably about 180 horsepower as opposed to the 170 that the street car makes. It's a few hundred pounds lighter because we've stripped everything out. Actually, only about 100 pounds. The MX-5 has so little extra stuff on it that by the time we put a cage back in, removing the interior, you know, we're lighter than stock, but not a ton. Stock transmission does a great job. Stock differential with a limited slip differential out of the Mazda Speed catalog. Nice mechanical limited slip as opposed to the viscous limited slips that a lot of manufacturers use. This one actually works, which is nice. Other than that, Hawk Blue brake pads, which have great initial bite, good torque, nice release characteristics. But other than that, the car is stock, other than safety equipment. And then the last thing, you're looking, you're saying, are those street tires on my race car? And you're darn skippy there, and there's a reason for that. It was great to be able to do this program and listen to the talks in the morning from the MX-5 design team, because that Kensai engineering, we've stumbled upon it here at Skip Barber. Not on purpose, because we're not as smart as Mazda, but we do our best. When we put these cars on a real race tire, like the BF Goodrich R1 that we use in the race series, the car goes faster. The R1, has anybody here driven on that? No. It's a pretty serious real deal race tire. The car definitely gets around the track faster. However, it's what we call overstuck. The MX-5 doesn't have 500 horsepower, and it wasn't engineered to have 500 horsepower. When you put a tire with that much grip on it, what happens is this race car won't slide that much. It won't rotate on the brakes. It won't spin the rear wheels just a little bit coming off the corner. When we put this tire on it, it's a really good balance. The BF Goodrich G4 Sport is a really awesome street tire. Really stiff sidewalls, really predictable. Its breakaway characteristics are very forgiving. It drives well at a decent slip angle, and so for our school purposes, it's a much more beneficial tire for education, because our students will be able to get that trail brake rotation. They will, as they release the brakes, get the car to rotate a little bit, because we've got a well-balanced car. If we put the big slicks on it, it's still a well-balanced car, but we'd have to be going so much faster that this track isn't big enough. So. That's the basic automobile. These things are really, really fun. They've got a good balance. They go pretty well. They stop really well. And they go around corners great. And they've got, like I said, a good race car. will give you an option of understeer or oversteer pretty much everywhere. And this car does that on these tires, and that's why we do that. So, other than that, all we got is a basically stock MX-5 with a very unforgiving interior. We've got our roll cage here, and our roll cage serves two purposes. One, it keeps a good green earth off your head if you decide to go inverted. And two, it assists you in doing the two most dangerous things you're gonna do all day. Do we have any guesses what the two most dangerous
things?
Getting in and out of the car. You guys are smart. That is where we injure more students here than anything else. Some of them on the way in, most of them on the way out. So I'm gonna, and it's genuinely on the way out. Because I mean, once you do that, you know, get in the box and go to the hospital. So, unfortunately, you do this.
Right.
It's a bad deal. So, what I'm gonna do right now, I'm gonna show you, because I'm such a giving, caring person, I want you guys to be safe. I'm gonna put myself at risk here, and wearing no safety equipment other than UV blocking sunglasses, I am going to get into this race car, and then, for my final trick, I'll get out. Okay? All right. So first things first, I know Bo and Luke Duke didn't need to open the doors, but you do, and here's why. This isn't as big a spot as, let me see this. You'll notice that's not a lot of room for forgiveness, right? We don't want you bashing your head around. Also, there's not a real clear strategy here. One of the funniest things I've ever seen was a student at a different operation going for a hot lap who decided to try and get in the car, put one leg, and then said, well, I guess I should get my head in here. And did this.
Oh, no. Nice.
And then that poor lady was stuck for about 5 minutes. And that is a bad look. And I don't think any of you came here to look stupid, did you?
I'm willing to take a picture and send it to Jim O and Robert.
That's right. And that's the problem with looking dumb, is everybody is willing to take a picture of you looking dumb. So why do crash videos have so many more hits on YouTube than when you just show a good lap? It makes everybody feel better about themselves. So, first things first, our roll cage. That's our buddy. He's our good friend. He's going to keep us safe. So you come up here, make initial contact. I've got a good firm anchor point here. Feet go in first, always. Right foot in, put it on the seat. Then you go ahead, left foot in, thread it down into the footwell. I got two hands on the roll cage. This is where people do, that's how they get hurt. So, sit on this door bar. Give yourself a second. Thread your second foot down in there. That's important. And then just drop yourself in. Look at that.
Bam.
Pretty good, huh?
Yeah, well done.
It's my first day. So once you're in, first things first, we need to get comfortable. Well, nobody was supposed to put that there. It's supposed to be there. There we go. So first things first, ooh, that's not good, right? I can't get the clutch all the way down. That's why I suck at basketball. Yeah, I'm not tall enough here. I can't get the throttle all the way down, and that's a big problem. So you never want to ever have your knee locked for any operation. So, guess what? It's a mostly stock automobile. It's got sliders. Let's see. Hey, Tyler.
Sort of.
Somebody railed it too far back. It's stuck. You want to give me a hand?
You just need to be pushed.
If they go all the way back, they can get a little sticky.
This is the car I was sitting in.
So now, see that? I got a nice bend in my leg. I might want to go a little bit closer because I'm American. I like to sit right up on the wheel. So right now, look at that. Get the throttle all the way down. Nice bend in my knee. Nice bend in my knee. I'm not going to be overextending my leg for braking. Next thing, before I start doing up my belts, let's make sure the wheel works. The wheel. Got to grab this little ring on the back, and this line at the top. You see the master key on the spline there? Just go ahead and put it on. Now, does that look like it's on? Kinda.
Yes.
Kinda. He's sharp, but he can see what I can see. Does that look like it's on?
No.
This is like the fail safe. It's only halfway on, but you gotta make sure, push it all the way down. You'll see that steering column come up to the bevel in the wheel. Does that look good? That looks good. So I've got a nice 90 degree bend in my elbow. That's about what you want. I know this looks close. You know, we watched The Fast and the Furious, and Vin Diesel made it very clear that you're supposed to drive like this. Problem is, that's not a whole lot of range, and you're ending up steering with your back and your shoulder muscles. Those are muscles we have for building houses. Those are not muscles we have for the fine control of a race car. So I sit close so I can use my control muscles for that sensitive feel behind the wheel. So, well, like this, I'll be steering with my arms and my wrists nice and gentle. And you can see I don't have to hold on very hard. If I'm way back here, I gotta really put a grip on it. So this feels good to me. So, doing up my seat belts. These Sparco belts, they're cam lock, which means there's no order. Anybody here remember the old school, the duckbill style belts? Yeah. I do because we still have them on our formula cars.
Do you?
Where there actually is an order, and if you don't do it in order, it doesn't work. These, there is no order. It's full on anarchy, but it's great because it's a lot easier. So you just grab this. It might be on your right belt. It might be on your sub strap, but either way, find your sub strap. Don't ask the mechanics to help you. That one's on your own. They don't get paid enough to find your substrap. And just start clicking them in. And you want to hear that nice click. That means that seatbelt's in there. Go ahead and grab my shoulder belt. Make sure you're not sitting on the window net. Some people, I don't know how they do it. They got the window net, it's like in their shoulder. And they're like, yeah, I can't find my window net. Is the seat also really uncomfortable? Because you're sitting on it. But so make sure that's off. Also, I'm leaving the door open so you guys can see what I'm doing. Close the door before you put your belts on. Does that make sense? Don't put your helmet on the hood of the car.